Hello everyone, welcome to our Law Excellence's initiative on current affairs for beginners that deals with various schemes, terms, institutions that appeared in today's Hindu paper that will help the beginners while reading the Hindu paper, and this makes easier for the beginners to understand Rambabu sir's news analysis video. Our first article is Gender Bias Caused Excess Deaths of Girls Under 5. In this article, we are going to see various terms like prenatal mortality, sex ratios. The first one is sex ratio. It is used to describe the number of females per 1,000 males. Sex ratio is a valuable source for finding the population of women in India and what is the ratio of women to that of men in India. According to 2011 census, it is 940 females per 1,000 males. The next one is total fertility rate. It is the average number of children that a woman can bear over her reproductive span, that is 15 to 49 years. According to 2011 census, it is 2.56 in India. The next one is child mortality rate. This refers to the death of children below 5 years per 1,000 live births. Infant mortality rate. This refers to the deaths of infants under the age of 1 year per 1,000 live births. This infant mortality rate includes prenatal mortality rate, neonatal mortality rate, and post-neonatal mortality rate. This prenatal mortality rate includes deaths from 22 weeks of pregnancy till 7th day of the delivery. Thus, this neonatal mortality includes deaths in the first 28 days of life. The post-neonatal mortality includes deaths after 28 days but before 1 year. The maternal mortality rate refers to number of women who die as a result of pregnancy and childbirth complications per 1 lakh live births in a given year. Our next article is Alien versus Alien. In this article, we'll see what is this National Register of Citizens. It is a list of Indian citizens that will decide who is a genuine Indian citizen, and those who fail to enlist in the register will be considered as illegal migrants. First list was made in 1951 across India according to the census of that year. And now this list is being updated in Assam. This NRC Assam is a register containing names of Indian citizens in Assam. It will contain the names of genuine Indian citizens and will help the government to check illegal migrants in India. NRC will be updated as per the provisions of Citizenship Act of 1955 and Citizenship Rules of 2003. It will include persons whose names appear in any of the electoral rolls up to the midnight of 24th March 1971 or NRC of 1951 and their descendants. This year of 1971 is chosen as per the Assam Accord agreed in 1985. We will see what is this Assam Accord. Assam Accord of 1985 was a memorandum of settlement that was signed between the representatives of Government of India and the leaders of Assam movement in New Delhi. Some of the key demands of this accord were all the foreigners who had entered Assam between 1951 and 61 should be given full citizenship, including the right to vote. Whereas Those entered after 1971 should be deported. The entrance between 1961 and 71 should be denied voting rights, but they will enjoy all other rights of citizenship. Whereas anyone who entered the state without documents after March 24, 1971 will be declared as foreigner and he'll be deported. However, the provisions in this Assam Accord were not implemented for a long time. Following this, another agreement called Tripartite Agreement was signed in 2005 between the Center, Assam Government and the All India Students Union, where the decision to update the NRC on the basis of NRC 1951 and electoral rolls up to 1971 was taken. The meeting has fixed a 2-year deadline to complete the exercise. As a result, a pilot project was also launched in some districts, but it got erupted due to violent agitations by groups who are opposing the NRC. As a result, the NRC update has got halted. Thereafter, again in 2009, an NGO called Assam Public Works has filed a petition in the Supreme Court demanding identification of Bangladeshi foreigners in the state and deletion of their names from the voters list. Finally, the Supreme Court ordered in 2013 to complete the exercise by December 31, 2017, leading to the present updating of NRC. Our next article is it possible to slow global warming? In this article, we are going to see what is this United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change is an international environment treaty. This is agreed at the United Nations Conference on Environment and Development, which is formerly known as Earth Summit, in 1992, that is held in Rio de Janeiro of Brazil. The main objective of this United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change is to stabilize greenhouse gas concentrations in the atmosphere at the level that will prevent dangerous consequences. The role of this United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change is to provide a framework for negotiating specific international treaties called as protocols that aim to set binding limits on greenhouse gases. Whereas this treaty itself has set no binding limits on the greenhouse gas emissions for individual countries. Whereas it will provide a framework for the protocols that aim to set binding limits on greenhouse gases. And 197 member countries have ratified this United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. These nations who have signed this convention will meet every year to discuss climate change strategy. And these meetings are called as Conference of Parties. This Conference of Parties is the supreme decision-making body of UNFCCC. All the states that are parties to the convention are represented at Conference of Parties. They promote the effective implementation of this convention. The first Conference of Parties meeting was held in Berlin, Germany in March 1995. Whereas the recent one, the 23rd Conference of Parties meeting was held in Bonn, Germany. In this article, there is also a mention of Paris Agreement. This Paris Agreement was adopted in Conference of Parties 21st meeting held in Paris, France. This agreement pertains to post-2020 climate actions. That means this agreement facilitates enforcement of global greenhouse emission reduction measures in the post-2020 scenario. The key objective of this agreement is to keep the global temperatures well below 2 degrees centigrade above pre-industrial levels and try to limit them even more to 1.5 degrees centigrade. And this treaty will come into force when 55 countries contributing to 55% of the total global emission ratify the agreement. Whereas India is the 62nd country to ratify the agreement. This agreement also stresses about the capacity building, that is, to strengthen the ability of the countries to deal with the impacts of climate change. And this agreement is legally binding on all parties. And this agreement requires all the parties to put forward their best efforts through nationally determined contributions. We'll see what are these nationally determined contributions. These are the national pledges by the countries to cut emissions voluntarily. This includes requirements that all parties report regularly on their emissions and on their implementation efforts. Every 5 years, there will be an assessment on the collective progress towards achieving the purpose of this agreement. Our India's intended nationally determined contributions are, they include a reduction in the emissions intensity of its GDP by 33 to 35% by 2030 from 2005 level. India has also pledged to create an additional carbon sink of 2.5 to 3 billion tons of carbon dioxide, that is equivalent to additional forest and tree cover by 2030. And India will anchor a global solar alliance, that is International Agency for Solar Policy and Application, of all the countries that are located between Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn. If we see, for USA, the INDCs were to reduce the absolute emissions by 26 to 28% below 2005 levels by 2025, whereas for China it is 60 to 65% below 2005 levels. For European Union it is 40% below 1990 levels. Our next article is Article 35A case for statute bench. In this article we are going to see what is this special status. This concept of special category state or special status was first introduced in 1969 when the 5th Finance Commission sought to provide certain disadvantaged states with preferential treatment in the form of central assistance and tax breaks. Initially, only 3 states were granted with the special states. They are Assam, Nagaland, Jammu and Kashmir. But since then, 8 more have been included. Arunachal Pradesh, Himachal Pradesh, Manipur, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Sikkim, Tripura and Uttarakhand were also granted with this special category status. The reason for this special status is certain states, because of their inherent features, they have a very low resource base and cannot mobilize resources for development. Now let us see what are the features that are required for a special status. The first one is hilly and difficult terrain. Low population density or sizable share of tribal population. Strategic location along borders with neighboring countries. Economic and infrastructure backwardness. And the last one is non-viable nature of state finances. The decision to grant special category status lies with the National Development Council, composed of Prime Minister, Union Ministers, Chief Ministers and members of Planning Commission, who guide and review the working of Planning Commission. And also we can see in this article, there is a mention of various constitutional provisions like Article 35A, Article 370 and Article 368. We'll see what are those. Article 368. Part 20 of the Constitution of India has only one article, that is Article 368, that deals with the amendment of Constitution. As per this article, Parliament can add, amend or repeal any provision of the Constitution as per the procedure laid down for this purpose. However, in the Keshwananda Bharati case of 1973, the Supreme Court has ruled that Parliament cannot amend those provisions that constitute the basic structure of the Constitution. Now we'll see Article 370. Under Part 21 of the Constitution of India, which deals with temporary, transitional and special provisions, Article 370 is a temporary provision granting special autonomous status to Jammu and Kashmir. The next one is Article 35A. Article 35A of the Constitution empowers Jammu and Kashmir legislature to define permanent residence of the state. This was added through Constitution Order 1954 issued under Article 370 of the Constitution by the President of India and not by amending the Constitution under Article 368. The Jammu and Kashmir Constitution adopted on November 17, 1956 defines permanent resident as a person who was state subject on May 14, 1954 or who has been resident of Jammu and Kashmir for 10 years and has lawfully acquired immovable property in the state. And this provision of permanent resident will not allow people from outside the state of Jammu and Kashmir to work, settle or own any property in the state. This also denies property rights to women who marries a non-permanent resident and also to her children. Now, we'll see today's questions. With reference to the UNFCCC, which of the following statements are true? It was agreed during the Earth Summit 1992. The Conference of Parties is the supreme decision-making body of the convention. Paris Climate Agreement under United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change sets binding limits on greenhouse gas emissions like the Kyoto Protocol. Select the correct quote from below. Our second question is, which of the following are the features required for special category status? Strategic location along the borders with neighboring countries, hilly and difficult terrain, economic and infrastructural backwardness. Select the correct quote from below. Post your answers in the comment box and answers will be discussed in tomorrow's video. Thank you.